All right, so thank you to everybody for joining the call today. I'm really excited to share methods and tools to help keep you safe from cybercrime. We'll be focused today on how to secure your environment no matter where the user is connecting from. We feel this is even more important today as we've all started working from home and it's become ubiquitous. When we send employees home, we lose the sense of security we get from having an enterprise firewall protecting the perimeter. The firewall is still a critical component of your security stance, but doesn't do much for current users' mobility, cloud-based applications, complicated phishing schemes, or really any of the modern attack strategies used today. I think most organizations can agree that security is critical for protecting your reputation, finances, and intellectual property. Yet 77% of IT professionals say their team is unprepared for today's cybersecurity challenges. The reality is we have state-sponsored, organized crimes, individuals all committing cybercrime at an escalating rate. The biggest targets are American businesses and government entities. If a hacker wants to get to you and your users, they have many tools at their disposal to make that happen. Having said that, there are many things we can do to make it harder for these jerks. The more difficult, the more likely they are to go to an easier target. Put another way, you don't have to outrun the bear, you just need to outrun the guy next to you. So make it difficult to find an entry into your business, and they're likely to move on to your competitor that hasn't made an investment in proper tools and education. So before we get really into all that, wanted to bring up a couple things. Obviously things have changed dramatically. We're all working from home, and I want to share a little bit about our own experience working from home and kind of the best practices we've used. So first off, that home environment, you got to think through, what does the end user's environment look like? How is sound going to be represented in there? Are there background sounds or issues from that perspective in the space they are? What kind of lighting do they have? We actually bought staff inexpensive USB powered selfie sticks, or selfie lights to help them so they get that good view. Are they in a space where they maybe need a green screen to kind of block out the background or other users? That's really great for unattractive environments. And technology, make sure they have access to applications, bandwidth, et cetera. How are you gonna support these users from home, both the device and the user itself? It can be very challenging when you don't have that local access to it. Obviously, how you're gonna do training, collaboration, and you can't overlook security. A really critical component of working from home is having some good headset. A lot of people use traditional headphones or something like that. The quality is not going to be the same. The talk time is not going to be the same. The noise canceling is not going to be the same. Making that investment is really a great thing to do. Having a strategy around communication. So for group interactions or regular cadence for check-ins, training on how to use virtual tools, all these things are really critical as we are moving forward to make sure we're staying connected as a community. And we have daily huddles that we have within our various groups. We make sure to video chat all our employees on a regular basis, and they know what that cadence feels like and what the expectation is. So you want to set the routine, set the expectations, and encourage others to share and lean into the small talk. An idea that can kind of help with this is make sure that for those remote meetings, you encourage the use of video, obviously. But beyond that, take turns facilitating the meeting. Let other people lead that meeting and lead the technology and really get comfortable with it and become proficient. So having said that, that's all we're gonna cover in terms of the best practices of riding out the storm here. We're gonna focus in on security specifically. So phishing attacks are the most common thing we're gonna deal with here. It's a type of attack used to steal user data, login credentials, credit card numbers, and other data. The attacker traditionally masquerades as a trusted entity, like a coworker, a supplier, customer, a bank, and then dupes the victim into opening a message of some sort that leads to a malicious link that's designed to imitate the service and collect login credentials, pay fraudulent invoices, or gain that credit card info. Phishing can also be used to gain a foothold into an organization once inside malware is distributed and they gain access to your privileged secure data. This is far and away the largest attack vector for those looking to hack. Email is ubiquitous across organizations, with many users processing hundreds a day. Identifying the one that poses a danger isn't always easy. So let's talk a little bit about what this looks like. First, spoofed branded emails. Spoofed email is a mass distribution to the organization across a wide variety of different organizations, with an email traditionally claiming that passwords are about to expire or they need to log in for some reason. They're looking for people to fall for that spoof. All they need is one person at your organization to fall for it, and now they have access. Beyond that, if they have shared credentials for example, email and VPN access, they can use that VPN access to get onto your network and have complete access to your systems. Another big one that's related but not quite the same is spear phishing, whaling, or BEC. BEC is business email compromise. So business email compromise, they pose as an upper-level executive by mimicking the text, style, and log of the standard organizational email template. So it looks like it's coming from a CEO, a CFO, a C-level. And they'll do things like, ask you to pay an invoice to a fraudulent company, wire money, and those sort of things. These are very, very common. 65% of attacks in 2019 actually use spear phishing, which is that really targeted attack to get to you. Government and those that publish their hierarchy on their webpage are especially prone to this. So if you've got your executive team posted up there with email addresses and information, hackers are looking for that because they can identify who those players are, what they look like, get some canned emails, and really get an opportunity to get to you. So FACC is an Australian aerospace company and a part maker. And they lost $61 million in a CEO fraud scam. The attacker impersonated the CEO and sent a phishing email to an entry-level accounting employee who transferred funds to an account for a fake project. The really frightening thing for those that are in that, you know, role of leadership and executive leadership, the former CEO and CFO are former. On top of that, they're being sued by the company for not doing enough to protect the company. This is a huge liability for C-suite, allowing piercing of the corporate veil, and something everybody needs to be thinking about. On top of that, just keep in mind that these hackers are very innovative. They're now targeting coronavirus as a tool. Hackers have impersonated the Johns Hopkins data map. I'm sure a lot of you have been there and seen the Johns Hopkins data map, really cool tool, but they're actually using that and mimicking it to distribute malware. Another thing we're seeing in that same vein, we're seeing phishing using World Health Organization. So they'll send out alerts and notifications and best practices about COVID-19, and it's actually a spoofed email. The links are malicious. So a little bit on some of the stats here. FBI estimates that $12 billion was stolen over a five-year span between 2014 and 2019. That's $17,700 a minute. Phishing attacks are up 72% in the last 5 years. This is the direction that people are going. And 1 in 25 branded emails, just the branded emails themselves, are actually phishing. And 4% of all email is some sort of phishing. 94% of malware was delivered by email. So we just have to remember that that malware is getting in through our users through one place primarily, via the email attack vector. Keep in mind that specific departments are really, really at risk. Specifically, finance faced 59% of phishing attacks in America. They need extra time, they need extra tools and extra processes to make sure that they're protected. So let's talk a little bit about how malware works. So malware attacks are malicious software that is installed in your system without your consent or knowledge. It'll attach to a legitimate code and propagate. It can lurk in useful applications. It can replicate itself across the internet. The code can be deployed through phishing schemes as well as known vulnerabilities or exploits. Some traditional ones that we see out in the real world today are macroviruses. These typically attach to applications like Excel or Word and execute viruses when opened. Then it replicates across that to other code in the computer system. A really, really scary one right now is fileless malware, also known as zero footprint attack. They don't install new software, so traditional antivirus services can't catch it. You need behavioral analytics in order to find that type of virus. It goes to the website via the browser, and it lives in RAM, so it's really hard to identify. And of course, most people have heard about ransomware. It blocks access to victims' data and threatens to publish or delete unless ransom is paid. The advanced versions of these attacks use cryptoviral extortion, so they encrypt the victim's files in a way that makes them impossible to retrieve unless you have the decrypt key, which of course you have to pay for. And another one that's kind of come and gone a bit is crypto mining, still happening, but not quite as regular, using your corporate CPU to mine new Bitcoin for illegal hackers. They love those servers, so they like to take advantage of it and use all that processing power to make themselves some money. here's some examples, some different malware attacks in 2019. So Ryuk, used by Grim Spider, which is most likely a Russian crime ring, raked in 3.7 million in Bitcoin in less than 5 months. Its predecessor was Hermes. So it encrypts files that can only be recovered with that private encryption key, which is obtained by paying the ransom. Traditionally, it's delivered via spam email using TrickBot, which is a modular banking Trojan that targets sensitive info and acts as a dropper for other malware like Ryuk, where the user downloads an attachment or a link to a malicious website where the download occurs. Once on the network, it uses PowerShell to connect to a remote IP address with anti-logging scripts. Then it crawls your network and moves laterally using remote desktop protocol. It continues to crawl until privileges are recovered to obtain access to the domain controller. From that, PSExec is used to push out the Ryuk binary to hosts. Batch scripts are executed to terminate processes and services and remove backups, followed by the Ryuk binary. From there, you get encryption of all your data, a ransom letter, and a whole lot of pain. An example, Maze. So an attack in Pensacola, Florida, the city of Pensacola demanded ransom to decrypt. Through that attack, another company, Allied Universal, who had ties to the city, ended up infected as well. It is believed that that second attack was initiated using information gathered from the city. So we're seeing more and more of this type of behavior where you'll see into one entity and moving sideways across into other entities. Combined between the two, they paid $3.3 million in ransom. EchoBot is a different type of malware that attacks known vulnerabilities, specifically in unpatched IoT devices. So routers, firewalls, IP cameras, server management utilities, online payment systems. They infect the connected device, targeting that vulnerability. An interesting example of this is Yacht Control. So Yacht Control gives owners of yachts the ability to remotely control the functions of their vessels. With this vulnerability, a hacker can actually get into the yacht and start taking control of said yacht remotely without the knowledge of the owner. Really scary one is new exploits in home routers. We're seeing what's called DNS hijacking, which is rerouting the DNS registries and taking people to malicious sites instead of the original sites they were trying to get to. Known vulnerabilities include products from Asus, Dell, Netgear, LG, VMware, Ubiquiti, Linksys, D-Link, and even Yealink phones. This is especially concerning as a large swath of vulnerabilities involve home routers or users we're now depending on. The router will redirect those DNS queries to the malicious sites, leaving your users exposed. So a little bit about stats on malware. So 1 in 5 computers were subject to at least one malware class web attack in 2019. Attacks on IoT devices, all those connected devices that we have out there, the cameras, the thermostats, et cetera, tripled in the first half of 2019. Really scary is this CVE, the Common Vulnerabilities and Exploits. There are 11,000 exploitable vulnerabilities known as of mid-2019, and only 34% had any known patches for it. And the other 68%, have you actually patched it? So these are all things we need to start thinking about. And if you think you don't need to worry about it because you're a smaller business, actually 43% of cyber attacks are on small businesses, 31% on those less than 250 employees. Much like I described before, they believe that smaller businesses are easier targets and they can move laterally into other businesses from there. Also keep in mind, this is a really tough industry. More than 300,000 security jobs are going unfilled. Finding qualified, quality people is hard for big businesses, let alone the small to mid-sized business. You need to have a strong partner and plan. Most attacks take 6 months to detect. So by then they're deep into your systems and it's very hard to deal with. Having a playbook of how you're gonna handle that and a process to identify it is really critical. All right, so what are some things we can do to protect ourselves? As a leader of Matrix Networks, security is of the utmost importance to myself. We're entrusted by our clients with access to their networks, private communication platforms. The process of ensuring a secure environment is a marathon, not a sprint. We need to take it day by day and continue to improve our security posture. Since then, we have been executing on our plan to really focus on improving that and making sure that we're delivering for our clients and our users a really secure environment. And as we've gone through that process, we actually eat our own dog food. We use all the tools that we're going to talk about today, and we're going to demo on our own existing environment. So a couple things to think about. Employee education was kind of the first place we wanted to go. We wanted to teach people about how to identify phishing schemes and campaigns, how to have good password hygiene, making sure that they're doing the things that they need to do. Also having a process for verification of identity through other official channels beyond email. So, you know, if an email is sent asking for a wire transfer, it does require more verification than just accepting said email as a real thing. And do be aware that there's deep fake voice now that can actually mimic the voice of CEO if they have enough data. Create a process of maintaining patches on all network connected devices. Consult that CVE for known vulnerabilities. You also want to check account statements and credit reports regularly. Have a process for that and someone that's responsible and accountable to that. And of course, invest in cybersecurity insurance is really a strong practice for the executive team to protect themselves, including for fiduciary mistakes like we described earlier with the company with the sued CFO and CEO. So when we're looking at this and the way we would approach it, there's really a couple different things to consider. We all know about securing the perimeter, right? So the firewall, your wireless, we need to make sure all of those pieces are secured. But it's the way I look at it, it's a little like layers of an onion. So the first thing is we know that the primary attack vector is going to be email. So let's make sure we're cleaning out as much as possible of the malicious email that's coming to our users so that they don't even have an opportunity to click on a malicious link and download something, enter credentials, et cetera. The next step in that is multi-factor authentication. So the ability to have both a device and a piece of knowledge to be able to get access to systems. So they have the device, traditionally a cell phone. They have an app loaded that requires biometric face ID in order to get into it. From there, they can authorize access after entering a password and make sure that your data is staying safe. And even if they do have credentials walk away, they can't actually get in. We also advise that when you do multi-factor authentication, you do SSO, single sign-on, to make life easy for your end users. We can kind of talk through that in another time. One thing to note about MFA is that less than 10% of businesses have deployed it. And when we talk about outrunning the guy next to you, having something that 90% of your competitors don't have is going to be a major leg up. Also, a strong wireless security practices. So understanding that others can mimic your SSID and lure people on to their network by presenting as though they are your SSID. Another thing that we'll see is man in the middle on public unencrypted wireless. Have you encrypted your wireless? Is it highly available? What's going across it? You need to understand what your plans are. Security operations center. Some people have run a SOC, some people don't, but the bottom line is that if you're concerned about security, you need a process to be checking on it regularly. You need people that are responsible to it. This is not a set it or forget it process. It requires tending like a garden. And segmentation of data. You know, it was shocking to me to learn that 53% of companies had over 1,000 sensitive files that were available to every employee, whether they needed to have access or not. Simply by just segmenting our data, we reduce our exposure and reduce our risk. And of course, encrypt your internet communications, as we are doing right now. Okay, so what can Matrix Networks do to help? We can help you review your current security posture so you can outrun your peers. We can help you design and source the right technology and service, thinking about your specific needs. Do you have PCI compliance? Do you have HIPAA compliance? Are you transitioning with financial data? How important is the security and what are the crown jewels of the organization? We can advise you on best practices for ongoing security, and we can help you enable remote users today to provide the level of security that they need to remain trusted endpoints on the system. So investing in your time and money in your security practices is really critical, especially like we said, for those that have compliance needs or financial data. The bad news is the enemy's on the move. It's creative and well-funded. The good news is there are amazing tools on the market to ensure we don't become an easy target. Our goal is to help our clients achieve the peace of mind we feel when we go to bed at night. So with that, I am gonna pass it off to my good friend and colleague, Jeremy Ness.
Thanks, Kyle. So with all that information, what can we do to protect ourselves? So I will be doing a live demo here. These are the different products I'll be covering. So advanced email security being the Cisco Cloud Email Security, multi-factor and SSO being Cisco Duo, the Umbrella DNS layer filtering, and then AMP for endpoints. As Kyle mentioned, I do want to just reiterate that this is all our environment. This is not a sandbox environment. This is we have all of these security products deployed, so all of this will be in a live environment. I also want to point out these are all cloud delivered, so none of these require any equipment on site. They're all being administrated and maintained, all the backends by Cisco, and then again all the agents more or less call home to those. All administration portals, analytics, telemetry is all done on those cloud-based portals. So with that, I always like to do, kind of where are we at, where are we, coming from, and where are we going, right? What's our kind of end goal here? So with that, previously to just a few weeks ago, traditionally we all kind of had these firewalls at the headquarters, typically going to be some kind of, UTM or a Unified Threat Managed Firewall. With that, we're typically going to have a, IPS, IDS, being primarily kind of signature-based security for servers. Often going to have some kind of gateway antivirus or, anti-malware. Beyond that, we'll probably have some kind of, botnet filter and a content filtering, right, to stop from going to, adult content or tasteless sites or other things of that nature. So again, prior to two and a half weeks ago, say most businesses, the majority of the users were kind of behind that UTM or that firewall. However, we've been saying for a while, perimeter's dead, we'll have mobile devices, we're coming and going from the environment. So oftentimes we see some kind of antivirus or some other kind of endpoint protection deployed on users' devices. So when they do roam on and off the network, we still have some level of protection on those endpoints. So let me introduce you to our employee here, Bob. So Bob is not the most tech savvy guy and really does not pay very good attention to security. So as any good business, we have ran Bob through security awareness training. He gets regular phishing emails, which he does fail regularly. So I send him through more security training, but for whatever reason, Bob's just not getting it. So what does Bob open up our business to? So say we have some malicious hacker, and they're going to be probably more of a spray and pray, right? Let's say Bob isn't even targeted. Bob is just normal end user. So one way that the attacker might hit Bob is might send an email, right? This might be phishing, booby trapped. Let's say in this case, it's some kind of fileless malware being delivered through an Adobe PDF. So let's say Bob's been off the reservation for a while, hasn't been regularly updated by our corporate mechanism. So this malicious attacker sends an email through Office 365. We use Office 365. Vast majority of our clients use Office 365. When you think about it, Office 365 is really just cloud-hosted Exchange, right? It's even called Exchange Online. It's great for sending and receiving emails, storing emails, and there is some security built into it, but is that Microsoft's job? I mean, really, you're buying a hosted email server. You're not buying a security product on top of that. So, say a malicious attacker sends an email, that makes it through, Office 365's filter. Bob gets that. He says, oh, I have some FedEx package, right? Oh, that's weird. There's FedEx tracking in this PDF. Let me open it. And all of a sudden, Bob's workstation gets owned. Being fileless, there's a good chance that the antivirus won't get it. Now attackers potentially have a foothold to land and expand in your network. Another thing we could possibly do as a malicious attacker is to possibly say Bob loves sports, right? So Bob is an avid soccer fan. Unfortunately, Bob's pretty bored lately since that's all been canceled. But saying he's trying to watch some old games. So he's looking around and he kind of ends and finds himself on some shady, media streaming sites. This shady site says, he needs some, media player .exe. Bob says, oh, okay, I just need this thing to run. Give me a Chrome extension. I mean, these can present themselves in a lot of ways. So of course, you know, Bob clicks on that, says, oh yeah, I need this media player. And, you know, feature many UTMs as a SSL man in the middle. However, I very regularly see that not turned on due to a whole lot of reasons, being takes a lot of horsepower to intercept an SSL, craft a cert on the fly, re-encrypt it. Can also be difficult to deploy, excuse me, needing to deploy an SSL certificate. So I often see that not on. Well, with that not on, you know, if that's not known site by, you know, botnet filter, that content filter, and it's a good way, you know, good chance it might make it through the firewall. So again, Bob clicks it, downloads it. Again, hopefully our AV is going to stop it, you know, knowing that the signatures are up to place and our mp.exe has a known signature on it. So, again, that's going to be best case scenario. A few possible points there that, you know, Bob's going to get himself infected. But at least we have something in place, right, being our you know, firewall with the unified threat management. And again, hopefully we do have the AV. Prior to Matrix deploying, and I see this a lot of clients, we did rely on Windows 10 Defender. Did a decent job, but we don't have, you know, essential reporting and remediation getting you difficult. So, you know, at least having some desktop security is a good point. However, we've even moved on past antivirus, which I will touch on in the demo. So what happens when Bob goes home? So again, possibly have some endpoint protection. Beyond that, Bob is, you know, sitting on a corporate asset at home. Who knows the state of Bob's network at home, knowing that Bob really has, you know, no concept of what he's doing, which is our average end user, right? I mean, we wish well had a whole fleet of IT people that knew what they're doing. However, IT people are typically not good at selling things and other things of that nature, right? They're needed in most of our businesses. So at home, what do we want to do for Bob? We want to wrap Bob in a whole blanket of security. We want to just smother this, you know, smother this end user in security. So if we're talking about this Office 365, what can we deploy? So again, today we'll be looking at Cisco Cloud Email Security. With that, that just sits in front of Office 365 or any other mail provider you have. Any inbound email will then go through all of the checks in Cloud Email Security, which again, I'll be elaborating on here shortly. Then it then passes on all that clean email to Office 365. So hopefully any booby traps, you know, PDFs, Excel, you know, macro spreadsheets, any phishing, generally anything, you know, that again is going to get Bob, allow himself to get in trouble, will be filtered out. So if we move on from that, how do we keep Bob going from shady sites? Again, that's going to be Umbrella. Umbrella being a very lightweight DNS-based filtering, which again I'll touch on in the demo. So say somehow Bob just, you know, rams him through all these barriers. Again, maybe there's something on his network already, and he does end up getting something on his device. Beyond that, we'll be talking about, again, AMP for endpoints being an EDR or endpoint detection response solution. Any virus typically runs off of a signature or pattern base, to where security researchers find something in the wild, they say, hey, this is bad. They take a signature, some type of hash of it. All those signatures get loaded into the antivirus client. However, things are moving so quickly, and those antivirus clients are really incapable of keeping, you know, every signature ever known. So AMP does have a signature portion of it. However, it does move on that more behavioral, right? Like, hey, this person only doesn't, you know, run PowerShell. That's odd. You know, maybe I should shut that down. There's a lot more, which I will get in the demo. Lastly, let's say that, you know, a phishing does not come through an email and it comes through a website, right? So hopefully Umbrella is going to stop that. But if it's extremely new, there's a chance it might slip through. So, you know, if Bob's credentials do walk away, we have Duo. And it's not even maybe what Bob does right now. Maybe Bob has horrible password hygiene and uses the same password everywhere, right? I love puppies, 123. Bob, that's a terrible password, but it's easy for Bob to remember. So he's on his bank, he uses on Facebook, he uses it everywhere. And he uses it on your corporate network, right? It has uppercase, lowercase, number, symbol. Boom, Bob is good to go. It's like 12 digits. If his credentials do ever walk away, or a credential stuffing attack is used by an attacker, you know, Duo will be in that second layer of security. And this becomes especially important, right? I mean, we have a lot of SaaS applications that your credentials may plug into, but with so many of us operating off of VPN now, you maybe open up the door for Bob to work from home with that VPN. Well, now he can use those same credentials, you know, Bob at your corp with puppy, other puppies, 123, and all of a sudden they're in the VPN and on your corporate network. So again, Bob is really the CISO's worst nightmare here, right? Security team's worst nightmare, but you know, I think Bob is gonna be more our average user than anybody else. So on to the demos. So first I wanted to touch on Cisco Talos. So Cisco Talos is Cisco's threat response and threat researchers. So there's 250 employees that are real-time looking at email, looking at websites, malware samples, and they really create all the threat feeds that sit behind all of the products we're gonna look at today. So again, we have kind of these multiple solutions, but really behind them is this one group that is just, you know, always constantly looking at emails, again, URLs. On average, they process via, you know, Cisco security products up to 600 billion emails a month, 16 billion web requests a day. That was 16 billion emails a day and web requests a day. And they have 1.5 million, you know, plus malware samples that they've gone through. So kind of like this little map, we do see average spam volume for March daily being 291 billion, which is actually down, which is nice. I do also want to point out, you know, shout out to these guys. They do undercover a lot of threats. So there's a lot of CVEs that are attributed to Talos. So 0 day, these are Talos reports that they've found from vendor issues they've reported the vendors. And then vulnerabilities have actually disclosed. And for anybody not familiar with Talos or is more interested in security, they run an awesome blog, awesome newsletter, and they also have an awesome podcast. So those are things, you know, as a security practitioner myself, that you know, part of my holistic, you know, learning of all these different platforms. So first, we're going to start with that email, right? So this is the most common way that threats are going to enter our environment, being, you know, that phishing and malware. And again, a lot of these are gonna be that kind of spray and pray, right? Where you guys are just pumping out tons of email, hoping it ends up in some inbox like Bob, who's just an unwitting user and is gonna go through and open these things. So again, this is our environment for the last day. So as you can see here, about 92% of our inbound email has just immediately filtered out, just gone, with only, you know, about 5.5% actually be delivered into our Office 365 tenant. On the right-hand side here, we'll see the threat message breakdown. So I love this reputation filter, 99.2%. So what that is again, via Talos and having all these other products deployed, Cisco just gets a tremendous amount of information about the reputation of domains and IP addresses. So those 99.2 weren't even accepted. They weren't checked for spam. They weren't checked to make sure they weren't malicious, you know, booby trap, PDF, macro file. They were just denied. Didn't even look at them. Didn't even consider looking at them for spam. So I think that's really powerful, right? Down here we can see anti-spam of those. You know, 83 were like, well, I'm not sure if this is just totally bad. So I'm gonna go ahead and look at it. Oh yeah, 83 of those know that made it through were good. Were spam. And then content filter, right? So 51% were filtered out by content filtering. So that's actually reading the email, looking at the links, following the links, right? Do these links point to somewhere? So this email originated from a server that I don't know is necessarily bad, but all of a sudden I scan the contents of the email and it's gonna take my end user somewhere they do not wanna go. Beyond that, we have a ton of great information here, just kind of analytics over time. Other great things we can look at is, you know, hey, what got filtered out by virus, by macro protection, by AMP or the, you know, advanced malware patrol or protection. I really like this kind of outbreak filter for like for the last week. So this is going to show us kind of a breakdown of, you know, phishing, malware, even things like dating scams, right? A lot of people will, you know, lost a lot of money, you know, over a dating scam, like, oh, hey, send me money and I'll come visit you. So great to filter all those out. Another thing I love to look at is this URL filtering. So this top part is the actual URL category. So these are not things that were blocked, right? I find these like very interesting informational things of what kind of emails or what kind of categories are my end users are receiving. So no surprise for our environment, you know, or company, Matrix Networks, computers, internet's gonna be top, and you know, with business, infrastructure, SaaS. But it's kind of interesting to scroll down to the bottom and just see things down here like, oh, streaming. And of course, you can easily, you know, filter down into these and see who's receiving what emails. You also see top spam domains, and then URLs, right? So again, this is going to be that, This is going to be that content filtering, right? So this is actually, hey, we're not sure if that email is bad. So we're not just, you know, reputation filtering it up front. But beyond that, we're going to look at all the URLs, follow the URLs. Are those known malicious URLs? If so, block them. So again, this reason this is so low is that reputation filter is going to shut anything down that it absolutely knows is bad. Anything knows is good. It just lets it go, right? Hey, we know this is a good reputation. So anything that's kind of in that middle is that gray area that we're looking at. And another one I like to see, again, there's a bunch of great information here, but I have a lot to fit in, is connections by country. So this is another one of those like, hey, you know, I'm receiving an abnormal amount of, you know, email from other countries. Again, the solution in a whole is going to take a lot of that into account in its filtering. But again, we can see United States here, but you know, so it's kind of interesting to scroll down. And again, you can drill down into any of these and actually see what emails are sent from unexpected places. So again, to wrap up the email portion, this is the Cisco Cloud Email Security product. Sits in front of any existing email you have. Again, we happen to have Office 365. If you still find yourself to be on premises, again, this can easily fit in front of any email solution. So again, hopefully that took care of Bob in terms of him being emailed anything that he just wanted to get really click happy on and open and possibly infect his endpoint and or our network. So next here is Cisco Umbrella. So Cisco Umbrella, again, is a DNS or domain name server service based solution. So what this does is anytime we want to go anywhere or do anything, be in a web browser application, we need to resolve a host name to an IP address. So if I go to salesforce.com, that query will go out to a DNS server and it'll return the IP or internet protocol addresses. So where those servers actually live on the internet. So you do that today, we all do that. However, nice thing about sending all those queries to Umbrella is now we can have security and policy wrapped around those and really protect our end users from going anywhere they don't want to go. So here in the overview page, we get a kind of great breakdown of the last 24 hours. So again, how many DNS requests we've had. There's a built-in proxy, which I'll touch on, which is really cool. Again, blocks, security blocks, of those security blocks, how much are malware, phishing, you know, C2, you know, botnet, crypto mining, and then kind of what applications are being used. So a lot of great information just up front, which again, you can schedule this and get this in your inbox every day just to look at the last 24 hours and make sure that that makes sense. So there are a lot of ways to deploy this. That's another thing I really like about the product is getting it up and working fast is very easy. We can use DNS forwarders on our Active Directory servers, which again, is more of an on-premise. At this point, since we're so much working from home, I'm really going to focus on just the roaming computers. So the roaming computers is a client that gets installed on any remote device, being laptops and cell phones, iOS, Android. So any endpoint that we want to protect that's roaming on or off our network, we'd want to install that roaming client on. So here we can find Bob's computer. So this is Bob. We can see that Umbrella is running on his computer and checked in 33 minutes ago. So with this, yes, Bob is protected. Bob also has DNS layer security. So again, the roaming client is gonna take all of our queries and send them to Umbrella for scrubbing, logging, policy. However, another really cool thing this does is it uses DNS crypt. So typically DNS is a plain text or unencrypted. So when you send that traffic across the network, if there's a man in the middle, you know, in general, anybody can see that query, mess with that query potentially. So what this does is it encrypts the query from my desktop all the way up to, or from my endpoint all the way up to Umbrella. So as Kyle mentioned, you know, home routers kind of, you know, being owned and having those routers then give out, you know, DNS that's malicious to computers in your home. It doesn't matter. Bob could have a malicious, you know, DNS server given to him over his router. However, Umbrella is going to override that and then additionally encrypt this query all the way to Umbrella. Umbrella or the roaming client also allows us for IP layer enforcement. So I keep saying DNS, right? So if attacker infrastructure isn't being accessed via a host name or a human kind of readable name and it's being accessed via an IP address, Umbrella can also stop that. So as a capability saying, oh, hey, you're going to an IP that's known to be malicious, I'm also going to shut that down. It's pretty rare to have attacker infrastructure on an IP address just because it's very easy to black hole that and block that. So oftentimes we see domain names with domain name generators used and all that, but if that is the case, Umbrella can additionally shut that down. So policies. So now that we've deployed Umbrella in any fashion, again, there's a bunch of deployment methods that I'd love to get into. However, again, the most applicable in this working from home environment can be that roaming client. So now we have Umbrella deployed in some fashion, we create policies. So these policies apply to identities. So identities are going to be anything from a roaming client to an Active Directory user, Active Directory group, a subnet. So you can even have a subnet that, hey, that's my PC environment, that's my HIP environment, that's my DMZ environment. I can apply different policies to even different internal subnets. If you have multiple branches, I can apply policy by external IP. So I see an IP query coming from a certain router, being branch over here versus branch over here. I can also apply a policy to that. So again, very granular. And the other great thing is I can drag and drop these so they apply. So I can do things like here, we can see matrix networks at number 3. So if they're in the office, they're going to have one policy, and then roaming computers, if they leave the office, have another policy. It's again really powerful in terms of being able to granularly apply policy to different identities. So here I have my most robust rigid policy, which has Bob's computer in it, right? Bob being the problem user here, he has his own policy. Again, here on the left-hand side, you can see kind of things I mentioned being the different identities that can then be applied to policies. So in this policy, we've turned on pretty close to full security for Bob here. So again, our kind of usual victims or usual suspects that are normally UTM would block, right? Being the malware, the command and control, the C2s, the phishing, potentially harmful sites, crypto mining. I've blocked all those from Bob. So again, since he's no longer behind our UTM, we can still keep him safe. Then this also integrates with other Cisco security products, being AMP ThreatGrid is what I have here. I'll touch on the AMP demo, but essentially ThreatGrid is a really awesome kind of private virus total, if you will, that has sandboxing capabilities. So we can actually run software, see what it does, report on it. So if it's something unknown, we can actually execute it in a sandbox environment. Next thing we've set up for Bob is content filtering. Again, something that would typically be enforced when Bob is behind our UTM. However, now that Bob's at home, we still don't want him looking at all this stuff. So again, a bunch of categories here. We've kind of set Bob up just so that he doesn't go to any adult content or other kind of shady sites on our corporate issue device. With Bob, maybe it makes sense to turn this thing all the way up. Who knows? We can also block applications. Again, we've kind of touched on security, general content filtering, and then actual individual application. So we're blocking Bob from going into anonymizer sites, trying to bypass any of the security that we've tried to wrap Bob in. And also, we don't want him, going any shady, torrenting or Usenet or any other sites of that nature. And one of my really favorite features about Umbrella, really excited about this, guys, is this intelligent proxy. So with intelligent proxy, for those not knowing, a proxy is to, take a connection and send it somewhere. So it's generally made through some kind of filter. However, often they're kind of heavy-handed, kind of a full tunnel, which is why I really like Umbrella. It's a very, very lightweight way to employ security. So what this intelligent proxy does is Umbrella knows some domains are really bad. Umbrella knows some domains are really good. But if we're in that gray area, we might want to actually look at the web page, right? Again, DNS just being these host names, IP addresses. I don't know really what's on that website outside of what Talos has done to go take a look at that. So intelligent proxy does is, oh, hey, I'm not exactly sure on that domain. And I'll actually run that single request up through Umbrella and do file analysis on it. So I can actually see the HTTP traffic, which typically you would not see in a DNS-based environment. And then again, with so much of the internet being encrypted, especially with the advent of Let's Encrypt, I think last time I've seen like 70 to 90%, depending on how you slice and dice the numbers, web traffic is encrypted now. As I touched on, a lot of UTMs do not have that SSL man in the middle enabled. However, here, anything gets steered to the proxy, we can run through SSL decryption. Then again, for Bob's policy, we are doing IP layer enforcement just to make sure Bob doesn't get in trouble. Again, a few more options down here. The other thing I'll touch on this policy is we have this guest SSID. That is not based on subnet. That is actually integration to Meraki MR access points. So it's a very cool integration. If you have Meraki access points, per an SSID, you can have an umbrella policy. So very cool. Again, more options here, but we're moving on. So what is any security solution not complete without reporting? So great, we did policy. We need to then turn around and see if that's doing what we want it to do. So from here, we can kind of see security events today. And and here's Bob, right? So we found Bob. Looks like Bob tried to go to icloud.iphp.us. Huh, that seems a little fishy. You can see here that we did get some HTML. So this actually was a domain that Umbrella maybe necessarily wasn't completely aware of. So it actually did proxy this request to this domain. But here, we don't have to rely on just what we see in that report. We can drill down into this and see, has anybody else gone to this, being another identity? Here we can see it was proxied and then ultimately blocked. And Umbrella has this really awesome console called Investigate. So this lets us drill down into this even more. So from here, it says, yes, we're phishing. Why is it phishing? Oh, wow. I mean, it's, it seems to be clearly phishing based on all these different indicators. So here's a history of the domain. So this domain just was created in February. So a fairly new domain. However, we don't really see really any queries until early March. So not uncommon for an attacker to set up infrastructure and just kind of sit on it. Oftentimes, you know, very new domains that are up have a poor reputation. So we can see that there's not a whole lot of queries going here, but somehow Bob, you know, ended up on it. So if we drill down more, some of the Gmail address registered the domain. That seems a little interesting. And here we find the hosted domain is in kind of the Eastern European area, with everybody being targeted in the US. So yes, you know, I do not think this is a false positive. I think Umbrella, even this being a brand new domain, has clearly identified this correctly as being phishing. And no matter how hard Bob tried to go to this fake iCloud website, he was blocked. So another component I really love is Cisco Umbrella is application discovery. So very often I'll walk to an environment and say, what are you guys using? Who's using what? You know, what cloud applications are you using? And it's often like, well, we're using these, we think, but I know this person over here uses this, and I think that department uses that. And you know, it's kind of that term shadow IT. Like, what application are we using? You know, as a security professional, as an IT department, should that be a question I'm not sure how to answer? I mean, that should really be a, yeah, I know we use these are approved, you know, these other are not. So here is the app discovery to help us with that. So right here, I can see that has logged us with 1,300 unreviewed apps. Again, we can have an audit, not approved, aka blocked or unapproved. So here we can kind of get some cool insight and this awesome DNS request by app risk. So app risk has nothing to do, well, a little bit to do, but not much to do with the actual security of the domain. Apps, it's a formula of the business risk, being, you know, financially stable and what's the reputation of the business. Usage risk, like is it highly used? It might be more risky if we use it a lot. And then vendor compliance, right? Are they HIPAA compliant, PCI compliant, ISO compliant? So all that kind of gets compounded into these different categories. So let's look at our unreviewed apps. All right, so a few kind of cool things we can do here. So we can sort this by identities, AKA the amount of users or computers that are accessing these applications, or the amount of DNS requests, which is fairly indicative of, you know, how much the app is being used. So if we sort by how much the app is being used, we see Akamai here being the largest CDN or content delivery network. So many of the apps you use store their information on Akamai to help distribute them globally and give faster access to their applications. So no surprise there. Second, Facebook, holy smokes. So again, as far as DNS requests, also a lot of identities. So in this time of everyone working at home, I guess maybe not a surprise, we want to feel more connected. Facebook is a way to do that. So I can drill down into Facebook, kind of see the risks here, and then I can look at the identities. So and I can sort by who are the top identities, you know, using Facebook. So again, Facebook maybe is not a security issue, but maybe it is an HR issue. So maybe it is like, hey, you know, I've seen this one user, you know, 20 times Facebook more than anybody else. That might be something that you want to, you know, raise up the flagpole to applicable departments, is that employee might not exactly be doing what we expect and hope them to be doing. Then again, we can sort by identities, get a different list. And again, there's 1,200 applications. Not all these are applications, you know, per se, with Google having here, we can see three right off the top, right? So there's even different portions of a company, those can denote different applications. And let's look at the applications we have approved. So again, these are applications that Matrix Networks has said, yes, we use, yes, they're approved. The nice thing is now that we're over here approved, we can even get more information about them, right? Oftentimes we do have application owners and who owns that, who uses that, what department uses this the most, right? And even in a shadow IT environment, that can be very useful, right? Like, oh, hey, half of our company is using box.com, but we've standardized on SharePoint. Maybe SharePoint isn't working for them. Let's go take a look, right? So a lot of just business insight here, even past the security use case. So at ours here, no surprise, we've got some ShoreTel communicator, you know, kind of call homes, or Unite. We have SharePoint. Yes, we're Office 365 shop. A lot of Meraki call homes. We do have the Meraki MDM, which I'll touch on later, which are most of those. And again, it's just kind of awesome here to just scroll through and see the applications used. And again, maybe we're using an application or it's been approved that's just not being used, right? So if we just scroll to the bottom, they're like, hey, we're paying a lot of money for that app and it's not even being used. So kind of a lot of great insight here. So there is plenty more to show on Umbrella, but we need to be moving on. So
Jeremy, recap. One thing from the audience out here. Can Umbrella show reporting based on Google search history per user?
No. And that is due to, again, being DNS-based filtering. We're going to see a call to google.com, right? We're going to see, hey, that requester user requested google.com. But that would not really give us insight into what they typed into google.com. That would require more of a proxy-based solution. Of course, Matrix Networks has in our portfolio, but is not intrinsically part of any of the applications I'm demoing today.
So I know that you did cover this a little bit, but we also have a question about what happens if a home router is affected with malware. Just maybe recapping that.
Absolutely. Again, with that roaming client deployed on the endpoint, it ignores any DNS that has been given to it via DHCP from the router. So it doesn't matter what's been given to it via DHCP. Any queries will you know, be redirected straight to Umbrella in an encrypted fashion. Some of the IT folks in the audience might be scared that I just said that. What about my internal domains, right? I don't want my internal domains hijacked. Of course, there's a way to say, hey, here's my Active Directory domains or other internal, you know, DNS zones I'm using. You can whitelist those. Those will go to the normal resolver with all other queries being sent to Umbrella.
Perfect. Great shirt, by the way, as you were.
Well, thank you. And thank you for the questions. Keep going. And as Ryan touched on in the beginning, myself and Todd, a Cisco security expert, will be available afterwards for any questions that you guys have. And of course, I love to demo all this stuff for anybody. So obviously I'm moving in a clip. So after the fact, you can reach out to your account executive Matrix for any additional demos.
One other question, Jeremy. Are any of these on trial basis right now?
Fantastic question, Kyle. So Cisco trying to do its part to help early introduce Cisco WebEx being available. Beyond that collaboration, it was clear that endpoints needed protection. So then they opened up Umbrella and Duo. This being Umbrella, Duo being the MFA, which I'll touch on, being available on trials through the end of June. Then they just recently introduced AMP for endpoints, which is what you're touching on next, actually that EDR solution. So all of those are available, kind of that unlimited, you know, trial up through the end of June. All right. So moving on from that, we have that I'm logged out of AMP for endpoints. So as I kind of touched on before, AMP has really moved beyond that traditional antivirus, right? So yes, there's a signature-based component, but there's much more. And as you'll see in the demo here, I also have a lot more information out of AMP for endpoints than I would a traditional, you know, kind of just antivirus solution. So here's the dashboard. So you get a nice look at, you know, any compromises, the type of threats I've had, the root cause of the threats. One thing I love here is, you know, all of the network connections it's looked at. Luckily, we had no threats there. I love this part too, vulnerabilities. So we're not just looking for, you know, known malware and bad things. Here, you know, just having a Firefox that's out of date can cause this issue. So if I drill down in this Firefox, which has an auto update mechanism typically, but if you haven't restarted in a long time or you haven't launched in a long time, maybe it has not updated. So here on this endpoint, we executed a quite old version of Firefox that has 15 known CVEs. So again, something you should be aware of, you know, it's not just malicious software, it's just also just old or vulnerable software that should not be running on our endpoints. So as we like to do on our journey here, let's go look at Bob. What has Bob gotten himself into? How is he looking from a security standpoint? So here we see his workstation, his definitions are up to date. That's great. That is one thing I see with kind of traditional antivirus is often that the controller or, you know, the main policy server can be stored at headquarters, right? So that's often how the reporting gets done and definitions. And they're also not always available externally. So it's very possible, depending on your solution, how it's deployed, that if you have it deployed, user goes home off the network, they might not get those definitions. Oftentimes they're gonna be in every once a week and we're fine with it. But again, that's another nice thing about all these cloud-based solutions. So from here I can see, yes, he's you know, getting his updates. His last scene currently, lately, he's on online on the network. So let's go ahead and look at the events. So these are things that have been flagged by AMP. And wow, big surprise here. Looks like Bob is managing himself highly infected here. So let's drill down on a few of these. So this is some ransomware, which any of the IT folks probably recognize that name as a test ransomware. So from that, I can see, oh, hey, here it is. Here's the fingerprint. A lot of options here. I can right click on it and see virus total. For those not aware, virus total is kind of a community site ran by Google, purchased by Google, that security researchers can upload samples. And it's kind of a common way that we can share malware samples and virus definitions. So 50 of 60, you know, say this is this malware. So I can probably believe that. When I got downloaded with this file name to this file path and the parent, right? So when malware gets on the machine, it's always like, how did this get in, right? Was it the USB stick in the parking lot, right? That age-old example. Was it Edge? Was it Firefox? Was it Chrome? Was it, you know, some other, you know, media player that he Bob had managed to download? So get some great information there. Another thing we can look at here that Bob managed to get himself infected, cloud indicator of compromise is PowerShell. Well, that's weird. PowerShell is normally an administrative tool and normally, you know, not used to download things necessarily. So Bob somehow ran some PowerShell to download something. And he went to some site on port 8081, not normal, to malware.htm. That's probably not good. So from here, if I right click, virus total is giving me nothing. You know, I'm kind of blind to what, you know, what did Bob get himself into here? So extremely cool part about AMP for Endpoints is it does look at all running processes and network connections. So here we can drill down. On the left-hand side, you'll see all the system processes running. You'll see all these funky little icons. Well, all those icons relate to all activity on the machine. Was a process created, copied, did they move, did it, you know, reboot, did it, you know, uninstall? I mean, just get the whole huge slew of events. So again, this is gonna be way past your typical antivirus or anything that a product built into Windows, like Windows Defender, is gonna have. So here I can see my PowerShell.exe being my culprit here, or culprit, excuse me. So we'll see what he's doing. And if we look at its parent process, it's Umbrella Diagnostics. So maybe help desk or somebody else was helping Bob. Of course, Bob can't get anything right, even the very easy Cisco Umbrella. So with that, we can see that was just part of the diagnostic. So we can resolve this, you know, events, call it a, hey, you know, I'm not concerned about that. Other thing I'll note here is this PowerShell. So we can see it executing. And then these little icons over here, a little bit hard to see, but are actually network connections. So here we can kind of see our call home to that IP address. So again, I can't really stress how powerful this is, being able to, per a process level, getting, did it create, copy, you know, access, encrypt, call home. You know, it just gives us a tremendous wealth of information here about what each process on the endpoints are doing. So if I wasn't sure about that, you know, some of this malware, what it's doing, I can analyze it. So what analyzing would do would upload it to AMP Threat Grid. So what Threat Grid does for us is, as mentioned earlier, it's a sandbox environment to where you can actually say, hey, I want to upload the sample. I run it to one in a Windows 7 or a Windows 10 environment, and let's see what it does. So I did find some malware, which was hard to do and get it past the parameters and upload it to AMP for endpoints and Threat Grid, but I managed to dodge our security and upload a sample. So with that, let's look at a report here. So again, this is a full Threat Grid report I just ran a few days ago. So we get a bunch of information. So indicators of the executable that I uploaded. So here off the bat, we can see it's probably just doing a whole bunch of bad stuff, right? Machine learning, it's probably malicious. Umbrella says it's bad. So here off the top, we can see DNS traffic. So it called out to what I would call some pretty shady domains, right? That's not even English, but obviously probably not something that Bob went to on his own. Again, we got a bunch of great information about that. The TCP, so any network connections that this malware tried to make. The process is running in the sandbox. Artifacts being actual programs, did this thing extract itself? Did it copy itself to the temp folder, the startup folder? Did it execute itself? Then registry keys being, did it put itself in the current user, run or run once or anything of that. So again, if there's any question about, hey, is this bad? What is it doing? Or even a post-mortem of like, what did this thing do? What steps do I need to take to clean it up? Just takes any guesswork out of that question. So we're back to Bob. So Bob clearly is infected. Bad stuff's happened on Bob's computer. So next up, remediation, depending on your security posture, maybe that's wiping the machine. Maybe that's running some anti-malware. Maybe that just the quarantining and the AMP is going to be enough. But one thing we could do before we do any of that is take a forensic snapshot. So kind of the historical data of what happened. So here's a snapshot of Bob's machine, and we just get a wealth of information. So executable's running, the ports they're listening on, shares he has open, all the files running, right? And all these hashes. And I can actually take these hashes, put them to Threat Grid, put them in AMP and see if they're running on anybody else's computer. Startup items, right? Did it copy itself into the startup item? Again, was that in the run key? Was that in the user hive, the local machine hive? So again, just a tremendous amount of information that we can get out of the machine here, and typically can be done before remediation. Or again, if you're just like, I don't know what Bob's doing, you can always old school remote into his desktop and try and do this manually, or you can use this awesome feature of AMP and just take a forensic snapshot. Beyond that, there's orbital search, which I don't even have time to touch on, but also a tremendous, tool. And lastly, we can say, hey, Bob, I can't even do remediation because you're at home, but you shouldn't be touching anything, so I can start isolation. What that does, that just shuts Bob down. Bob no longer has network connectivity, restricts any network communication except to the AMP dashboard, so they can un-isolate Bob if I sort of decide to in the future. I don't want to just orphan him. Maybe Bob has infected everybody else. So I can actually come up with an outbreak control, go simple, put any kind of file hashes that I think are spreading through the network. Anywhere AMP sees that file hash, shuts down that endpoint, right? So if we do have a ransomware outbreak to where this thing's rampant, right? You got some eternal blue kind of thing where it's jumped an SMB share, we can just shut that down. No more running to the server room, frantically pulling out network cables, unplugging network switches. If that's an option, right? Because a lot of these attacks do happen at night. So great, Jeremy, you showed me email, Umbrella, AMP. So am I just living in all these things all separately? How do I pull this together? How do I keep track of Bob? Knowing that he's doing all this kind of bad stuff. So what we can do is Cisco has a portal called Threat Grid. So Threat Response uses APIs exposed from all these individual products and pulls us into one. So I can do really cool things like take this hash and investigate it in the Threat Response. So this is now going through all the different modules we have, again, having the Umbrella AMP and email security, and just seeing, hey, how this thing get in, whose machine is it on, what did it do, and it puts us out in this really easy to see graph, right? So I can see it came in at edge, this XPO came in, it executed these, it sat in this file path here, here was the name of the file, it sat in two different file paths depending when it got executed, and finally targeted Bob's computer. So with this, I can easily clearly see that, hey, Bob is in and got infected. I can also take this hash and put it in the AMP and also show me any other computers that have that. So again, that up here we can see a few modules were used, being AMP and the file reputation. Again, this thing is also tied into our email, right? So if something came in through email and Umbrella saw it and AMP saw it, it'll lay that all out on this awesome graph. So for example, in Kyle's email here, we'll see what comes up. So here right away, we see this whole web, right? And obviously searching just for his email address is a little counterproductive. Typically in this investigation window, we put his email, any websites we're concerned about, any file hashes we're concerned about, any file names we're concerned about. So typically you wouldn't use just one piece of information to put that in. So again, from here, I can see Kyle sent all these emails, received these emails. Other people were CC'd on it. I can also take things like, hey, these email servers, the email server might be suspicious. So I can copy this IP address of that email server and see, hey, was there any web requests? Was there any AMP call homes to that server, right? Maybe this is attacker infrastructure that more than just email is on. So again, that's awesome threat response tied around, kind of bringing all of these products together. things that I would be remiss to say, especially with a Cisco employee being on, is that there's a brand new ShareX console that's coming out. So again, this is more of a threat hunter, threat response, kind of a big picture, pulling these all together, right? Day-to-day administration and individual analytics of the different portals, you would need to go to those portals specifically. To where ShareX really is gonna bring in all that into a single portal, and then additionally, Talos is going to have visibility in that portal too, being they have a threat response unit now, and we'll be able to assist with threat response on your individual environments. So again, threat response now ties these all in. Again, I can kind of see the individual modules being pulled into that. And then beyond that, again, there's a new ShareX that was just announced in RSA. Again, just kind of a visual of the modules, right? So this is hooking in our AMP. We have multiple email security appliances, the Orbital Search. So really awesome having that one console to pull all these together. So lastly, moving on to Duo. So again, this is our MFA and single sign-on solution. So again, this should be really wrapped around any logins anyone has. So your Office 365, if you have Cloud CRM, on-prem VPN. When people think of MFA, I feel like they often think about some kind of email loop, some SMS loop, or some kind of OTP or one-time password, right? The little scrolling digits. So when I log in my bank, I do have MFA turned on, but what that is I log on, I get a text or an email with some code, and I plug it in. Well, that is MFA, but my bank has no idea the security posture of anything in the mix, right? Was I logging on from my bank from a computer that had malware on it? Was I checking that email code from something that had malware on it that could grab that email code? With SMS, SIM hijacking has become more prevalent. We know the SS7 kind of PSTN infrastructure in general is very old without much authentication. So what Duo brings to the mix is going to be able to wrap this around any of your corporate applications, but also having visibility into the health of the authenticator, typically being your cell phone, accepting the Duo push, and then the endpoint visiting the application. So I get the health, and then I can also wrap policy around that. So let me get in and show you guys what that looks like. So here from the dashboard, we get kind of a quick overview of Matrix. So we have a few users bypassed, a few inactive users. These are users not used it in a while. We have 24 total employees enrolled in Duo with 78 endpoints. And again, endpoints could potentially be an authenticator, which could also be someone browsing, right? So your cell phone could be logging in your corporate apps, and then typically a laptop or desktop. So again, last 2 days, authentications and kind of a detailed authentications here. So we get device insights. And again, kind of talking about that security posture of the endpoint. So yes, we're an iOS shop. Most of our employees have company issued iOS phones with a few kind of BYOD Android phones. Surprisingly, we have no BlackBerry and no Windows phone. Not sure why, I'll check on that later. So with iOS here, we kind of get some version information. We can know that 13.4 is the latest with six of our devices, with 11 still being on the kind of the older. Then Android, we also get a peek into that. Tampered, right? It's the device jailbroken. In general, iOS devices are considered to be quite secure. Android, as long as you're not going to shady, your app stores are generally decent too. If one of your end users has gone and you know, jailbroken iOS with the new check rain, jailbreak, or Android, there's a whole slew of them, right? Screen lock, right? Is their phone just left open? If someone just opened, you know, finds their phone laying around, are they going to access that device? Biometrics, are they logging in with their face or thumbprint? And again, disk encryption. And then I can base policy based on this, right? Like if you're jailbroken, no. Screen lock, you don't have any of that, no. So let me jump into that. So we have a global policy, and then you can go create specific policies for specific applications, right? And all applications are the same. They don't have the same amount of sensitivity. So your CRM or email or password manager should probably be quite sensitive to where if your end users use maybe a smart sheet, which could have sensitive information, maybe a Zenefits or a Expensify, right? To where Expensify, they're submitting credit card receipts. I don't want someone in there, but at the same time, you know, I don't want them necessarily, somebody malicious getting in there. So kind of some highlights here. You can do location, so we can lock them down by location. So we only allow endpoints or pushes from Canada and the US. So anybody outside that, we never expect our workforce to be out of those two countries. They cannot authenticate into our apps. We can do trusted endpoints. We can deploy a certificate on those endpoints. Being, you know, hey, that's a company issued device. That's a certificate. You can go to our password manager. If you're at home, BYOD, you know, in your jammies in front of your computer, that who knows, right, Bob? We don't want him logging our password manager from his own computer. So trusted endpoints. Other things we can do is operating systems. So we do allow OS 10, but not end of life versions. We do allow Windows, iOS, again, BlackBerry, nope, sorry, Windows Phone, sorry. And any OS we don't really know about, being a you know, normal kind of operating system we'd expect to access our apps, not allowed. We do the same with the browsers. So we do a block list. We have a blocked Internet Explorer for many of our applications, being as it's generally considered to no longer be maintained. Plugins, do you have Java Flash? Again, there's a bunch more options here, but just know that we can really lay this policies around the disposition of an authenticator and endpoint to who can access our applications. Jeremy, what kind of applications can I protect? Virtually everything. I think you'd be hard pressed to not find a major application in here. Again, a lot of these are going to be SaaS, but we do have things like VPN, right? Now that VPN is so prevalent, any connect in your environment, you can wrap Duo around that. Citrix in your environment, we can wrap Duo around that. You know, even competitors of Cisco, beyond our FortiGates, right? We can do that too. So, and then, you know, Zoom, of course, I have to bring up Zoom in at least one conversation here. So, and then again, what is in a security solution without reporting? So if you go ahead and look at some of our authentications here, over the last 180 days, get a really good view of, again, how often are applications being accessed, who are they being accessed by, where are they being accessed from. So we can see there's been 183 denies. We can see what the authentication methods were. We did have one end user lose his phone and authenticator for a short amount of time. So he still had to do a win, but he couldn't use the authenticator app. So with that, he had to have it call him and verify it was him with a special code. So reasons for being denied, no response, right? You do have to kind of acknowledge within about 20 seconds or so. Invalid passcode being more that call-in or SMS. And then blocked, anonymous push. So if you try to log in very quickly, three or four times in a few seconds, that's potentially somebody credential stuffing, some bot trying to jam credentials in your application, right? Nope, you just tried three or four times, didn't even look at the authenticator, you're done. Anonymous IP, again, we don't want people coming from VPN or Tor. That was one of the policies, right? There's no legitimate reason any end user is accessing company resources or VPN over an anonymizer network. Again, location, being outside the US or Canada. So again, Duo is our awesome multi-factor. Being short on time here, I didn't even touch on the SSO part. So it says give a single sign-on so our same users can use credentials everywhere. Unfortunately, that does allow Bob to use I Love Puppies 123 on all the websites, but luckily we have Duo sitting there stopping anybody that does try to use Bob's credentials to get in. Lastly, I'll touch on, we deployed this a few days after, we all went home. So, we do not have a enterprise package management solution to Matrix. We generally rely on group policy to push out all of our software. Luckily, we do have Meraki System Manager being the MDM deployed on all of our endpoints. So it's very easy for us to come in. Hey, we want to deploy AMP. So again, we deployed AMP and Umbrella completely with everything off of the network. We also have no need to VPN into our environment. All of our applications are all cloud-based. So what we did, we drag and drop the AMP executable. We put in our few switches here, silent. And then we just said, hey, what service books do you want to play this to? Save, done. Same with Umbrella. So having some kind of package distribution technology, especially that more people are working from home, is really important. We're big fans of Cisco Meraki and the Systems Manager. There's a lot more it does beyond just package deployment, but it came in really handy having that deployed on our environment at this point in time. That concludes the demo portion. Again, I showed you just a fraction of the fraction of the piece of the applications available. With that said, take it back, Ryan.
Awesome, Jeremy. Thank you so much. That was a ton of great information, a lot to handle in a short period of time. As he mentioned, feel free to reach out to your favorite Matrix Networks account executive to set up your own personal demo or spend some time in the breakout rooms afterwards. Bob's a jerk, huh? God, you fire that guy. So now I'd like to pass it off to Tim Sutton, who is a representative of Big Leaf Networks, longtime SD-WAN partner, to showcase their new home network optimization solution. While this doesn't exactly fit into the security vein, this is obviously all about the home environment and how we can best support our end users. So Tim, the floor is yours, my man.
All right. Can everybody hear me? Just want to make sure audio is good.
You're good.
Perfect. Perfect. So I'm going to go ahead and share about the Big Leaf Home Office offering. And for those of you that aren't familiar with who Big Leaf is, we're an SD-WAN provider that's available to you through Matrix Networks. In fact, if you're using the connectivity as a service platform from Matrix, you most likely already have Big Leaf deployed to help manage and control your traffic in and out, as well as prioritize that traffic. So in many people, when you're thinking SD-WAN, and we're obviously an SD-WAN provider, you're thinking, well, that's for multiple sites, multiple connections. And although many SD-WAN providers are set up that way, before SD-WAN was a phrase, we were internet optimization. So we really provide intelligence around the internet. We allow for intelligent routing and prioritization of traffic for anywhere from a single site, hence a home office, all the way up to 100 plus sites. So we really are geared with our technology to be able to help manage this complex home office environment. So obviously we're seeing a rapidly evolving market as it pertains to home office connectivity and working from home. We had people slowly starting to migrate to doing some things from home with the ability of leveraging VoIP and SaaS and just being able to be more flexible. There's been a growth of remote workers, but obviously now with the mandated work from home, it's become significantly more important. And it's bringing about new connectivity challenges. I read an article the other day that because everybody's at home and people are working from home and kids are doing school from home and they're streaming, some major markets are actually having their internet capacity as a whole decrease by 40% for individual users because everybody's pulling from these shared network environments. So what are some of the challenges that remote workers are facing right now? There's multiple demands on the broadband, both business and non-business, school, kids streaming, everything else. In fact, as we're talking right now, I have probably three or four different streaming sessions going on in the background. residential internet connections, they are not reliable. You know, and consumer grade devices as far as the internet modems being used at home. Many users are experiencing dropped phone calls, choppy video conferences, also slow performance of business applications, and difficulty connecting back to the home office and the VPN. So with the Big Leaf Home Office, one of the keys with us in this SD-WAN space is we automate everything. We automate prioritization and routing of traffic, and we manage that internet connectivity in and out. So we have a cloud access network. We have a network to where we are going to take the connection from the house to our closest gateway or POP, and we're going to manage or control that connection. We automate prioritization. Like I said, we're on a video session here doing screen sharing and the VoIP, and this is all going on while my wife is working. And you know, we have three kids here at home that are hopefully doing schoolwork, but more than likely on Disney Plus or Netflix. So, we are single circuit friendly. In fact, at the end, I'm going to share a story about really where I've seen the value. I have two internet connections at my house, able to manage and load balance with the Big Leaf, but I'm going to share how I've seen value personally, even when I've only had one connection working. It really is an easy setup, plug and play, and it's a very flexible solution as well. So, and we provide full visibility into what's going on with the internet connectivity. So last thing I just wanted to share in a short slideshow presentation, just kind of the network setup. You can see basically internet connection coming in, going into the SD-WAN router, the Big Leaf. And then all traffic has to pass through the Big Leaf, so you do have an external Wi-Fi device for the home that would become the LAN for the home. And you can see traffic is routing out to our gateway, separating out all the mission-critical applications, while all the non-essential traffic is being deprioritized. One of the things I wanted to share is Matrix has the ability to provide, for those of you that are concerned about your home office connection going down completely, or your internet connection, Matrix can provide a 4G backup or failover that would allow you to be able to essentially always be connected at home. So even if your residential internet goes down, that would be able to take over. I did want to share one thing real briefly. Wanted to share one thing real briefly here regarding my dashboard, and just show from a prioritization perspective. So I have two internet connections coming in. I have a cable broadband that's my WAN port 1, and I have a DSL that's my WAN port 2. But what I wanted to focus on here briefly is the traffic rerouting and the packets protected. So Big Leaf has basically rerouted 123,000 application flows to protect from outages just in the last month at my house. The way that I'm able to operate at home is the same that I would in our corporate environment at corporate. And then on the right, the Big Leaf has actually protected over 1.8 million high priority packets, like what we're doing here, from delays or drops by leveraging our dynamic QoS. So I wanted to share that real briefly. One of the other things I wanted to share regarding the home office, this is something that we have rolled out as an answer to what's going on currently in the market and everybody needing to work from home. And as great as all of the applications are that people are using, you know, doing video conferencing and VoIP and SaaS applications, if you can't connect to it because those applications aren't prioritized on the network, it creates a lot of challenges. So one of the things that we have done is we're offering this as a month-to-month. I know we all hope that we can get back to business as usual as soon as possible. So we don't want anybody to be in long-term contracts or agreements with this solution. This is to answer the right now and being able to operate as closely as possible as to if you were in the office while at home. So with that, I'm going to stop sharing, and I'm going to just share a quick story. I have the two internet connections coming into my home, and I have twice in the last couple of months while doing a presentation like this, I've had my cable internet go hard down. And it failed over the DSL. Nobody knew. I knew that that would happen. I've had that happen a lot of times. But these two specific instances, while the cable internet was down, my DSL had latency spike to over 600 milliseconds. And I was experiencing a significant amount of jitter on that line. And yet neither I or the client knew that anything was going on. Because of how well we prioritize traffic over the network, it wasn't until we got to the dashboard and I was able to actually show what was happening with the connectivity. I literally, as I'm going through it with them, I was like, hey guys, look at what's been going on while we've been talking. We had one internet connection go down. The other one took over. That one was having significant issues, and yet none of us knew because of how we manage and control and prioritize the traffic. And so with that, it looks like, Ryan, there might be some questions.
I am just flooded with chats over here. If there was a question, I missed it, Tim.
No, I'm sorry. I saw the chats. I didn't know if that was in reference to this.
No, but you will be assigned to your breakout room here shortly. And I'm going to do something unprecedented. Tim, you good to go, my man? Anything left for me?
Yeah, that was it. Thank you for the opportunity to share. We obviously, we're just trying to solve some of the challenges that this unique experience and environment that we're in right now. We're just trying to help people be able to work from home.
Awesome. Well, I have just opened up all the breakout rooms. You're all randomly assigned to a happy hour session. You should have seen a notification pop up. Some of you have requested to be in some of our experts' rooms already, and you'll automatically join when you enter. That was insane to manage, by the way. Regardless, thank you to all of our experts. Thank you to Big Leaf Networks for sponsoring lunch today. We hope to provide this type of educational content ongoing while we all get through these troubling times together. I can't reiterate how awesome this is to have so many people on this call today. We hope to see you in the breakout sessions. And if not, we'll see you next time. Cheers.
Thanks, Ryan.